again, everyone. In today's lesson, we're going to be discussing commonly confused words in English. Now, there are a lot of words in English which either look the same or sound the same, or even worse, look and sound the same, but have very, very different meanings. And if that's not enough, there are a lot of words that look very, very different and have very similar meanings, which makes it difficult to decide which word is correct in any given context. Now, you've probably seen some confusing words together in other previous lessons, and hopefully together, we can clarify this issue a little bit for you. So first, let's look at some nouns. What do you think about the pair desert and dessert? Well, let me ask you a question about it. One, do camels live in a desert? Or, well, maybe I love eating desert. Perhaps you've noticed there's something wrong there. The problem is that desert, with one S, is a very large area which does not have any water, and very few plants can grow there. Deserts are covered by sand. You might be surprised to know that the famous Sahara Desert is only the third largest in the world. The largest, in fact, is the Antarctic Desert, the coldest, windiest, and most isolated continent on Earth. A dessert, on the other hand, with two S's, is something sweet, like cake or candies, that we usually eat at the end of the meal. Did you know, then, that the most expensive dessert in the world costs $25,000 and contains real gold? So now, let's repeat these words so that you have the pronunciation between these two perfect and very clear. First, desert, with one S, is an area of land without water, and dessert is something sweet that you eat after a meal. Now, another pair of nouns that people often confuse is peace and peace. Despite the difference in spelling, both of these nouns are pronounced exactly the same. So, do you know what this sign is called? If you answered peace, P-E-A-C-E, then you are absolutely right. Peace is when there is no war or violence in a country or area, and we all want to live in love, peace, freedom, and justice. As for the noun P-I-E-C-E, peace, this is usually used with the preposition of and is used to explain about part of an uncountable noun. And usually, it identifies something that has been cut or separated from the rest of the whole. For example, he cut a piece of pie. So, to fix it one more time in your memory, P-E-A-C-E is this. It's the favorite symbol of the hippies. And piece, P-I-E-C-E, as a big piece of cake, or even better, a big piece of pie. Remember, piece, P-I-E-C-E, of pie. I think I might have some after the lesson's finished. Now, there are quite a few English nouns that resemble verbs, adjectives, or even conjunctions as well. Let's have a look at some of these. First, let's look at sit and seat. One of these words is a noun, and one of them is a verb. So, what is your position right now? Correct, you are sitting in front of your computer. So the verb is to sit, spelled with an I. You can sit on a chair, a table, or maybe even the ground. As a result, a seat, spelled with E-A, is a place where you can sit. For example, when flying, I always prefer a window seat. What about you? Also, pay attention to the slight difference in pronunciation. The verb has the short I vowel sound, I, and the noun has the long vowel sound, in this case, seat. Now, the next pair of words that we're going to look at is one that is very, very difficult, even for many native speakers. We have affect and effect. Now, as the particle to suggests, The main difference between these two is that affect with an A is a verb and that effect with an E is a noun. And if you listen very carefully, there is a very slight difference in the way these two words are pronounced. As for the verb, it's a neutral sound, affect, whereas in the noun, we change the pronunciation to the E sound, effect. Thus, effect is a change or the result of a change that somebody or something causes in someone or something else. For example, I can certainly feel the effect of too many late nights. I can't concentrate on my reading. To affect, in turn, means to produce or to make a change in somebody or something. For example, too many late nights have affected my concentration. I can't finish reading this chapter for more than an hour. One more time. To affect with an A is the verb form, and effect with an E is the noun form. Let's consider some more examples of verb-noun pairs, the difference between which can be quite hard to determine. For example, the words advice and advise. One of these is a noun and one of them is a verb, but can you guess which one? If you said that advice with a CE at the end was the noun, you're correct. Now, advice is an opinion or a suggestion about what someone should do in a certain situation. For example, in the sentence, he gave me good advice on how to prepare for the exam. To advise is the verb for to give advice. For example, he advised me about the exam. So here, to advise with an SE is to give advice with a CE. The same pattern works for the pair practice and practice. Where the noun is spelled with a C, the verb is spelled with an S. And this pair of words has quite a few different meanings depending on the context. For example, I can say, it takes a lot of practice to speak English fluently. In this case, practice could mean doing an activity regularly so that you could improve your skill at it. I can rephrase the same sentence using the verb, you should practice a lot to speak English fluently. Don't be surprised if when you're typing in Microsoft Word, the word practice with an SE is flagged as being incorrect. By default, Microsoft Word is set to American English, like I speak. And in American English, we spell both variants with a CE. It's only in British English where it is different. Just know that practice with an SE is still correct. Now, let's move on to certain adjectives. Have you ever wondered what the difference between historic and historical is? Or economic and economical? Or quite possibly classic and classical? Now, there are a lot of adjectives containing the difference ick and ickle, and these all change their meaning depending on which suffix is used. But we'll focus on these three for right now. So, historic means historically important or influential. You can talk about a historic event, meaning an important event that happened in the past, such as the Battle of Waterloo. I can say that the Battle of Waterloo was a historic event. The same is true for buildings. For example, Windsor Castle is a historic building. And books. The Gutenberg Bible was a historic book. Now, historical, on the other hand, refers to something that occurs in the past or was made in the past or takes place in the past. For example, a historical event is simply something that happened in the past. Or if I'm talking about books, I can say that Leo Tolstoy's War and Peace is a historical book. It takes place in the past. But I don't have any other information than that. With the words classic and classical, the difference is in primarily how broadly the term applies. Classical, as a rule, has a much narrower meaning. Usually when we say classical, we're referring to things that come from ancient Greece or Rome. Or, on the other hand, if we're talking about music, music that was written in the Western musical tradition that predates 1900. For example, Mozart and Bach are considered to be classical composers. The adjective classic, however, has a much more general meaning, and it's used to describe something as being worth accepting or deserving to be accepted as one of the best or most important of its kind or of its time period. Remember War and Peace? Right, we would describe that as a classic novel. Classic novel, or classic, also is used to describe something that has all of the features you would expect to find in something. Basically, it's a typical example. For example, if you say she displays the classic symptoms of depression, you are saying that her behavior is very typical of someone who is suffering from depression. Finally, economic and economical, as distinct from the two previous pairs, have entirely different meanings. The adjective economic is used to describe anything that involves economy and economics. It's common to talk about economic growth or economic development, as well as something like economic reform. However, economical means something more like efficient. If I'm saying something is economical, it uses no more of something else than is required. For example, an economical wife is very good at controlling spending money, and an economical car does not use too much fuel. Now, let's look at some verb pairs that differ just in a few letters, which may make them very, very confusing to look at. For example, the verb pair lay and lie. Now, this becomes even more apparent when you start conjugating the verb pair. For example, I have lain here all night. So what's the difference between these two? To lie, in its first meaning, means to be in a horizontal position. For example, when I come home from work, I like to lie on the sofa. The verb lie always describes the subject and never the object. It's a kind of action that you can only do yourself. However, to lay means to put or to place something in a particular position. And it always needs an object, because the subject is always doing this to the object. For example, I laid my book on the bed last night. Wait a second, do you know where my book is? Oh, yeah. It's lying on the table because I laid it there a few minutes ago. Don't forget that the verb to lie has a second meaning of to deceive or to tell someone information which is not true. And watch out for the verb forms here. I lie all the time. I lied to him yesterday, and I have never lied in my life. So, congratulations. Those are a lot of the confusing words in English, and that's to the end of today's lesson. See you. Oh, wait. No, sorry, I've just lied to you. We have a few more examples up ahead. The next pair that I want us to look at is to raise and to rise. Raise, R-A-I-S-E, and to rise, R-I-S-E. The key difference between these verbs is that one of them is transitive, that means it takes an object, while the other one is intransitive and cannot be followed by an object. So, let's try and decide which one's which. Which one of these phrases sounds correct to you? To raise a hand or to rise a hand? If you said to raise a hand, you are correct. In this case, raise is a transitive verb. It takes an object. I raise my hand. However, rise does not take an object. My hand is rising. And it talks about the subject. Pay attention to the fact that to raise is a regular verb conjugated into the past with ed, raise, raised, raise. However, rise is an irregular verb. It should be the sun rises, the sun rose, and the sun has risen. Rise, rose, risen. Another verb pair that looks similar are the verbs to insure, E-N-S-U-R-E, and to insure, to I-N-S-U-R-E. Now, don't be tricked by the difference in spelling. Listen very closely to the way I pronounce them, and you'll hear that they sound exactly the same. To see the difference between these two verbs, let's look at let's imagine a story together. John comes to a special company and insures, with an E, his car, so that in case he damages it, the company will pay to fix it. 1 week later, he has a car accident, and he wants the money from the company, but he will never get it. Why? Because he made a mistake. John should have insured his car with an I, because the verb to insure, I-N-S-U-R-E, means to make an arrangement by which a company, according to their agreement, will pay for the costs if you are ill or if you damage something. This arrangement is called insurance, and likewise, these companies are called insurance companies. To insure, E-N-S-U-R-E, is to make sure that something happens or is definite. So think about this word just like to make sure. And one more time to make sure you remember the difference. To insure for a legal procedure. For example, my house is insured against fire and robbery. And to insure as the synonym for make sure. For example, it's a flight attendant's job to ensure that your seatbelt is fastened, which basically means that he or she needs to check and see if your seatbelt has in fact been fastened. So let's pass on to another pair of verbs, in this case verbs that sound and look different but have very, very similar meanings. Let's start with borrow and lend. So if you come up to your friend and say, "Can I lend some money from you?" and you see a puzzled expression on their face, it doesn't mean that your friend is greedy. The thing is you made a mistake. In this case, the verb to lend means to give something to someone or allow them to use something that belongs to you, which they have to return later. In this case, if I lend something, I am the person giving it. You can say, "I've lent my car to a friend," or you could ask your friend, "Could you lend me your car for a day?" Pay attention that when you ask someone to give you something, say, "Can you lend me?" but not, "Can I lend?" Now, let's go back to our first sentence, "Can I lend some money from you?" How can we fix this? Pretty simply, instead of lend, we should just say borrow. To borrow means to take something from somebody else, which you must return at a later date. For example, "Can I borrow your hat, by the way? It looks awesome." So here, if I lend it, I am the person giving it. And if I borrow it, I am the person taking it. Finally, let's end by considering a group of four words that many second language learners find difficult. In this case, say, tell, talk, and speak. Now, all of these are forms of communication, but it's a little bit more complicated than that. To say and to tell are both used with direct and indirect speech. The difference lies in what comes after the verb. To say is followed by a direct object that can be of four different types. It can be followed by direct speech, with words like something, nothing, much, a lot. It can be followed by a that clause, or it can be followed by a WH noun clause, especially in negative questions and sentences. Be careful, as to say is never followed directly by a direct object pronoun, and this is one of the most common mistakes that students will make. For example, you cannot say, "He said me something about going skiing in Austria." If you want to say, to say, with a direct object, you must include the preposition to. And the use of say to someone is quite limited and quite rare, and only occurs with long clauses beginning with that. For example, he said to me that he was going skiing in Austria and that I could reach him by email. Now, if you want to mention a person that you're addressing your words to, it's much more common in English to use the verb to tell. However, tell in English is a transitive verb and requires an object. And so it's almost always followed by an indirect object. Here, she told me that it was my last chance. It's worth noting that to tell can occur in a very limited set of phrases without an indirect object pronoun, with a limited number of direct objects. For example, to tell a lie, or to tell a story, to tell the truth, and to tell secrets. But other than these set expressions, to tell cannot be followed by a direct object. For example, she told that it was my last chance. To speak, on the other hand, is used to talk about one-way communication or about very formal communication. For example, the ambassador and I spoke of the need to improve farmers' living conditions. To speak is also the verb you want to use if you want to talk about your knowledge and ability to use different languages. For example, a man named Ziad Fazal, who is currently living in Brazil, claims that he can speak 59 languages. And finally, to talk is a verb with a very general meaning, and it means spoken language to express oneself. It can describe one-way or two-way communication. For example, he talked non-stop for an hour, we stopped talking immediately. As a rule, to talk does not occur with a direct object, except with a few set expressions. For example, to talk shop, or to talk about work, or to talk politics, or to talk sports. Now, I'd love to say that we've covered all of the confusing words in English, but unfortunately, that's not quite true. There are some more English words that students find difficult to differentiate. But I'm sure now that you're well aware of this concept, you'll be paying close attention. I highly recommend that when you encounter words like this that you find difficult, you make a note of them, write them down, and discuss the difference inside this. Just like for idioms, and just like for any other important phrases that you may have had trouble learning, just keep track of them, and study them, and review them. Now, don't forget to do the activities included with this lesson, because you may see a few words in there that I didn't quite have time to discuss today, and I don't want you to miss out on any of the material included in this course. So, review the material and do the exercises, and you may need to study this a few times. This is not information that you will remember quickly, so be sure to review and review. And I'll see you in the next lesson.